So finishing up the proving ground to submit it. We make sure we save it. Make sure you save it as a different name than assignment one or assignment two. I like to go to save more and go to the PSB option. And that will show you how much memory it's taking. I'm not sure why it's stuck. Because these are big files, right? Haha. I think I confused it. And I think I had saved it before. Let me do this quick. Photo P. And I'm going to bring in my latest PSD. Come on, work with me here. Close some tabs. Don't need the texture overlays anymore. Everything's slow. Seems like a connection problem. There we go. So it kicked in. Okay. So my file is 304 megabytes. Some of yours are bigger than this. Some of yours are smaller than this. It depends on how you had to crop and how you had to make your resolution work. And that's okay. So I'm going to save that. I hope. And I can check if any of this is responsive just by right-clicking. Yeah, the browser's working. Yeah, I'm just going to close this, open up a new photo P, because I'm pretty good about saving as I go. I just wasn't trying to save in that special way. And then just open it up. It's been working great. All right, and it's got all my texture overlays on there. And so this is the finished piece, right? So you make sure it's saved as a PSD. I've got mine. Now you're going to save it under export as a JPEG. There's no transparency you need to support, so JPEG is fine. I'm going to take it down. I mean, 70% or higher is great. So this is good. Now it's going to save to your downloads. So you want to move it from there, once it's saved, into your folder. And this is what you're going to submit to Canvas for your proving ground. But before you do that, there's a nice little trick you can do. You can double-click it and open your JPEG in preview. And then you can go to Tools and adjust color. And remember levels and color balance and hue saturation. This gives you control of all that in just one place pretty quickly. And you can always click auto levels and just see if you like that better. Right? Because often when we add these texture overlays, things can get dulled overall. And so all auto levels does, you can see it in the histogram here, is it just pinches the highlights and the shadows a little bit so that it's not kind of middle contrasted. It's just a little sharpened. You can also play with whether you want it overall brighter or overall darker. I might go a little bit brighter overall. But I want to be careful not to have like bright, bright whites lost. So I can adjust the histogram right here. Just like editing a photo, right? If there's just things that look kind of weird, you can brighten your shadows. You can deaden your highlights a little bit. Some of those foreground highlights are a little extreme, so maybe I will deaden them a little. And then you have saturation. You want to see if it's readable in black and white. Mine's extremely colorful, so it needs to also read in black and white. So I might actually take a little bit of that saturation down. Temperature, this is color balance, right? Do I want it to go cooler or do I want it to go warmer? I can go a little bit warmer overall. The tint, It's pretty good. I guess it could go a little bit towards magenta to counter those greens. And then you should not need this. This is sharpness. But this is if you have something low res that you want to appear sharper, often helpful for websites, you can increase the sharpness. If I do it here, it might exaggerate it, but I already have plenty of sharpness. So, subtle difference, but this is just like final retouching, which doesn't hurt your PSD at all. These are like easy adjustments you just do to the JPEG. Okay, now you can close Photopea. We go to Canvas. We go to where Proving Ground 1 is for our class, 2348-006. And right under the directions, you're going to start a post following this to get credit. Give your name. Underneath that, you're going to use the upload, upload image, and you're going to find your JPEG, not your PSD. And that's the one I just used preview to kind of sharpen a little bit and bring out the contrast, bring back the color. And all you're going to be judged on for this is whether the angle of your character's anatomy and whether its lighting matches the environment. That's the part of the proving ground rubric. It's right here. Number 2. Do you match the light direction and the angle of the anatomy? Did you place your PNG creature onto a landscape background image in a way that utilized a common light direction and accommodated for the angle of your creature's anatomy? If you did both of those things, you'll get full credit for that part of the proving ground. The next part of the proving ground is the first thing in the rubric. This is understanding your data. So we need to accurately identify the resolution, the pixels per inch, and the physical format, you know, also known as the print size, the desired physical size. And then while also identifying which of the two main types of digital art resolution your creaturescape is appropriately sized for. That would be screen resolution or print resolution. So first of all, I need to go back to my JPEG, open it up. I can do this in Photopea as well, going to Photopea image, image size, but I can also do it right in preview. Go to tools and adjust size. And I just need to see how many inches it is by what resolution. That's its physical dimensions by its resolution. There's no judgment here. There's no wrong answer. You just need to accurately identify the data. So mine is 9.75 by 11 inches. So I'm going to write that underneath. This is just as important as putting your creature in the landscape. And you usually do the horizontal measurement first. So 9.75 inches, you use quotations, full quotations for inches, by 11 inches. At how many pixels per inch? 350, that's my studio resolution. Pixels, that's PPI, pixels per inch. Now I need to identify, is that good enough for printing? So this tests your knowledge. It's a requirement, right? Standard minimum print resolution is 300 pixels per inch at your desired size. For this class, everything to be a desired size has to be at least 8 by 10 inches. So mine is over 8 by 10 inches, even cropped, and at 300 or larger than pixels per inch. So this is good for, I'll put it in caps, print resolution. Post. Those are the first two steps. Why I posted it is now I'm going to make a duplicate of this JPEG and show you what it might also look like if you didn't have enough resolution. So I'm going to actually open it up. I'm going to go to Tools, Adjust Size. I don't want you to do this. I'm going to have resample image checked, and I'm going to change it to 100 pixels per inch at by 12 by 13.64, all right? So what if my image was this? Because I cropped it, and when I look at the image size, either in Photopea under image, image size, or here under tools, adjust size, I'll see that my resolution is only 100 and my width is bigger than 8 by 10. So how can I see if it's big enough for printing? Well, what I would do is I have to uncheck resample, because resample creates pixels, right? And now my pixels are locked. So I'm seeing what can I get from these pixels. And if you want to print it, it has to be 300 pixels per inch. And so this image at 300 pixels per inch is only 4 by 4.5, which is too small. It's beneath 8 by 10. No judgment, that's fine. But what you want to do then is change it from 300 to 72 pixels per inch. Because what you want is a physical format bigger than 8 by 10 or 8 by 10. So at 72, this image is 16 inches by 18 inches. So then what I would do is write 16 inches by 18 inches at 72 pixels per inch. And why 72? Because 72 pixels per inch is the standard minimum resolution for screens. So you wouldn't say print resolution, you would say screen resolution. Yes? So if it's not big enough for 8 by 10 at 300 pixels per inch, you have to set it at 72 pixels per inch and tell us how big it is then at screen resolution. Both are fine. It's just you need to know that about your image in order to know how to use it. This is all about applying our knowledge. Next, you're going to write a description. This is the last part of the rubric. Did you explain how your creature is intended to interact with its environment? In your post, accounting for atmospheric and practical concerns, how does your creature breathe, shelter, and eat in this environment? This is also where you can give kind of your species a name, whatever it is. So let me give myself some room so I can look at my creature. These are the things I've been thinking about as I'm creating it, right? Like, what does it eat? How does it hide? What am I going to call it? This striped marsupial. That will be the species I use here. It's a striped marsupial. I guess I'll put it all in caps. Lives in the underbrush of the vegan jungles. Feasting on grubs and aphids that would otherwise decimate the forests. So I'm setting up a symbiotic relationship here. So it does that for the jungle. What does the jungle do for it? It is incredibly active and must stay awake for 80% of the solar cycle, because this might be a place where they don't have our days and sun and all that. It is incredibly active and must stay awake for 80% of the solar cycle to cover such an extensive range, like foraging range, to do this, its ears and what do we want to call it? And horns can absorb and hold the oxygen so rich in the atmosphere. And it's all BS, right? But you're thinking it through and seeing if it works. And it might give you ideas about how that creature would interact and why this mist is so heavy. I want to show that this is an incredibly oxygen-rich atmosphere, right, with so many plants. Its favorite delicacy